to this this session of ACRI Bangalore chapter event. My name is Dipti. I'm the Bangalore chapter host. ACRI, as most of you will already know, is Arts and Culture Resources India. We are a platform for knowledge sharing, for networking, skill building, all for arts managers and arts professionals who are living, working, and based in India. We are very happy to have you all today. This is the first ACRI Bangalore session for 2021 after what has been a fairly challenging year for all of us. So very happy to be having this conversation, which we wanted to have in a slightly more intimate format. Digital fatigue is very, very real. So we thought that it would be better to have a chat first, and then perhaps if there is interest in the wider community to take this to a larger audience. ACRI has now presence in 4 cities, although this was before the pandemic hit where we started thinking about city chapters. But in the 4 cities of Mumbai, Chennai, Bangalore, and hopefully soon Delhi as the 5th chapter, we're looking at what each city's cultural ecosystem's particular needs are. And what we're hoping to do is to program events that address that community's particular needs, wants, and trends. In the digital era, what we've done is we've tried to open up the topics so that anyone can attend. In pre-digital eras, of course, it was primarily restricted to people who were in the city at the point. But now with topics like today's session, while we are focusing and we're opening the conversation with Bangalore's arts professionals, we're inviting audiences from all over India because there is no real limit to learning that we can have between each other. So before I jump into today's session, I just wanted to tell you a little bit about ACRI's programs. We're going to be scheduling something from one of the 4 city chapters, hopefully 5th city chapter as well, on the 1st and 3rd Wednesdays of every month. We usually do it in the evenings so that people have a chance to finish their workday. And also at the end of March, on the 19th and 20th of March, ACRI's Arts Management Conference, which is called CultureCon, is coming up. We're going to be announcing the content of the sessions and so on and so forth soon. But you'll be able to see information about CultureCon in the chat over the course of this session. And particularly, this conference is for ACRI members. So you'll be able to see ACRI membership information in there as well. And you can always write to us at info@art-x.co to find out more about how to become a member. All right, with that, we'll jump into today's session, financial planning in Bengaluru's cultural ecosystem. We all are aware of how deeply impacted we've been with the COVID-19 pandemic. Livelihoods have been, in many instances, they've been devastated. Some of us have been able to pivot to digital. I think all of us have been working hard to stay sustainable, to survive. But that was 2020. We're trying to see what 2021 might look like, whether there is change, whether where we can find positive interactions, positive reinforcements for the kind of work that we do. And so the people that we have here today, I've invited 4 arts professionals who are based in Bangalore to tell us how they are looking at financial planning in Bengaluru. So I hope to throw some questions at them. You're all very welcome to write your questions in chat. All of the speakers will also be able to perhaps respond to you in chat. You can respond to each other in chat. This is meant to be a circle of sharing as well. So we'll begin with a few questions and then open up the floor to more discussion. So what I've also noticed is that in your RSVP, there were two main themes that came out. One is revenue streams. What are people doing to look at revenue streams in 2021, whether they're arts organizations, whether they are artists, independent professionals. So we will be talking about that. And the other major theme that we saw in the RSVP forms was financial sustainability. So we're going to be talking about that as well. So those are the two broad themes. There were, of course, other questions that came up. We will try to get to those as much as possible. There was one person who also asked about tax filing. So perhaps we'll look at that as a separate session if there is enough interest. So with that, I will invite all of my speakers to come on video and stay on mute for the moment. So we have Tejasvi Jain, who is founder and director of Reeriti. She works in the museum sector. We have Rebecca Spurgeon, who is the artistic director of Jagriti from the theater sector. We have Vishal Kumaraswamy, who is an independent artist, works with new media a lot. And we have Giridhar Udupa, who's a Carnatic musician, founder of the Udupa Foundation as well. So thank you all so much for joining me today. And looking forward to a super interesting conversation. So I want to sort of jump straight in. And I'll request all of the speakers to stay on mute unless you're speaking. So Tejasvi, I'll ask you first. In streamlining expenses and looking at as an organization to become lean, to sort of work in crisis mode, can you tell us about how you looked at your expenses, looked at prioritization? What is it that you said you absolutely must keep going, and what were you able to let go of?
Thank you, Dipti, for inviting me on this platform, and it's very exciting to be here. When the pandemic hit us, it was the end of the financial year ending, and we had already planned our budget and the activities for the next year, which is 2020. And we were going to undertake a major project which was supposed to be funded, self-funded by us through crowd fundraising and other sources of raising funds. So all that had to come for a standstill. And we were already into the research of that project. So we couldn't leave it midway. So what we did is we had to kind of shift the things which could be shifted to the next year. Like, for example, the traveling exhibition, which was associated with the research, that got shifted to the following year. But the classroom engagement, which we were able to shift and pivot and make it digital. So then that became a source of revenue generation, which also allowed us not only to opened our borders, not just Bangalore, but also Pan India. So for those who don't know a little bit about Reeriti, we basically work in the museum and culture sector. And we are in our three main focus areas are capacity building for museum professionals, consulting projects. We undertake consulting projects in the area of audience development for museums and heritage sites. And the third one is an initiative which is called Ritihas, which works with educational resources and looking at gaps in history curriculum and trying to make history relatable, relevant, and reachable for the school students. So these are our three main focus areas. So when the pandemic hit us, we had to quickly pivot this entire thing. Our museum consulting jobs in the initial months were slashed. We kind of went to 50% they slashed. And then in the end, towards November, December, that also was stopped. But luckily, we were able to get some new projects. So that was a saving grace, I feel. Also, we kind of bucketed our expenses into need to have and nice to have. And, you know, the other from the nice to have also had two categories, one which could be addressed in the near future and one which could be shifted to the next year. So that's how we were able to kind of, you know, balance out our expenses and cut it out. Also, our major expenses, because we are service oriented, our major expenses is our people, the people resources. So instead of letting go people, we cut down the days people were working. So instead of 6 days, we made it 4 days a week. So that way we were able to retain them with a slash in their salaries as well.
Super, thank you for that. And Tejasvi, you also mentioned to me separately, and I'd like to bring that up later, is that you've been having similar conversations with museum professionals. So I'd love to hear what else you can bring to this conversation from what you've learned from those conversations as well. But for now, Rebecca, as another organization, I'm gonna ask you the same question. How is it that you were able to look at all of the expenses that go into running Jagriti Theatre? Before you answer that question, Rebecca is artistic director of Jagriti Theatre. In fact, you took over about a year before the pandemic hit, am I right? So it's been quite a journey for you as well. So tell us, what is your approach like?
Thanks, Dipti, first of all, for having me here. I'm really excited to talk about all these very real things that happened last year that we're actually still reeling from and sort of recovering from. So I think one of the things that was a big deal to us to figure out at Jagriti was building costs, because while there are resources in terms of like people who work on the team, we were able to sort of just like Tejasvi just said, cut down number of days and sort of look if we could do a percentage, to pay them a percentage of their salary, which was lesser. I think one of the biggest things that became something that we needed to look at immediately was the running cost of the theater. And what we figured quite early on, even though initially in the month of March, when we thought we were going to come back in April, we figured that the core team could still come back to the theater and work out of the theater post the lockdown. But we figured that the number of days that we were keeping the building running was exponentially more expensive than we had sort of accounted for. So one of the immediate things we did is that we shut shop. We decided that we would close the building down and work remotely. And so we actually would meet, I think, once a week from about August or September, but we really only came back to work in Jan. So that meant that that we weren't paying for electricity, we weren't paying water, we weren't paying any utilities. Of course, there is a recovery period in terms of having to look at maintenance and stuff once you close the theater down. But I think that was a much more manageable cost compared to what we would have had to pay out otherwise. One of the things we also had going for us and have going for us is we do a 9-month education program, which is paid up front. And so we were able to sort of reorganize that and take those classes online. And that didn't need us to come back to the theater either. So different from some other theaters and some other cultural organizations, we didn't do any work online in terms of producing new work, which involved us coming back to the theater and sort of using electricity and lights and being back. So we actually were able to sustain ourselves in terms of minimizing expenditure rather than looking for new ways of generating an income, if that makes sense. So we sort of took that approach for the year. And we decided that however long it would go on, we would lie low. And we would sort of use whatever money we had and we had set aside for the year to sort of pay staff and just, you know, make those sort of small payments. And then now we're back in Jan. So that's kind of briefly what we did.
Okay, thanks for that. Can you also tell us very briefly about the Be Safe initiative? I know you, it's called something else as well, but for the benefit of who's here, the initiative and the waiver that you got from the government and how that might be something that the Bangalore community could build on, perhaps.
So the Be Safe, Be Safe, which Dipti just referred to, is this community of venues in Bangalore that came together very helpfully at the start of the pandemic. And it was great to sort of be able to share common fears and sort of also share resources and things that we were reading with other spaces and theaters and venues in the city. And we were able to initially just map out ways in which our spaces were different and therefore were able to do some events differently from the others. But the unifying feature of all the venues that belong to Be Safe is that we were all hit in the same way, in the sense that a majority of our income is generated by audiences and by programming for community. So in the absence of shows and ticket sales, it meant that the chunk of the money that we would make in the year didn't exist anymore. One of the things that, of course, we just briefly, for those of you who are here and would want to know, we started looking at various things that we could do to generate an income. That was the first thing, but also to ask for some sort of help from the government in terms of maybe a waiver on BESCOM bills or some sort of support towards utilities. That is a huge payment for buildings of our size. And it was a slow process, in the sense that, of course, with most government things, there's a lot of back and forth. But letters were written to the chief minister, and actually, to be quite honest, they were really helpful. So they've come back and said that we could claim a part of our BESCOM bills, a part of our utility bills could be waived. There are also, what we need to understand is that venues in Bangalore come under different categories. So there are public spaces, there are private public spaces. So, for example, Jagriti is a theater built on private land. So a lot of the grants and funding, even the support that's given by the government for public spaces doesn't really apply to us. But be that as it may, even a small waiver of like 5 or 10,000 goes a long way, especially now. So that was briefly some of the support that we received from the government. And I think if I'm not mistaken, I think the public spaces were able to claim, you know, further, like a bigger percentage of their utilities.
Okay. If anyone has information in the room about what Rebecca just spoke about, public spaces, whether they got a waiver, do share that in the chat. Well, thanks, Rebecca. I'm going to move to Giri Dharurupa. I call him Giri, fondly. Thanks, Giri, for joining us. I want to ask you, so we talked about outflow, right? Expenses. I'm interested in now looking at inflow. One of the questions that people have asked is about revenue streams and how are you looking at the different revenue streams, you as an independent artist, but I know you're also connected with the Udupa Foundation. So if you'd like to give us a sense of revenue streams that were existing before the pandemic hit, how that has changed and what you're looking forward to in 2021.
Hello, namaste everyone, and thanks Diti for inviting me. To start with, being a musician before 2020 BC, that's before COVID, I mean. So things were like normal. We used to play concerts, they used to pay, we used to travel everywhere, and this is a normal situation with everyone. And I would say that there's absolutely nothing to do with online streaming or online concept. There is no concept exist. Of course, with respect to teaching, it was there. If you had to teach an overseas student, we used to use the online Skype or any other platform to teach. But things have drastically changed since March when it comes to the concerts or the almost a year, there was no concerts. Slowly, people started exploring this online thing came into the picture. And there are a couple of plus and minus in having a, you know, online concerts. One of them is many organizers, especially the, I can say when I say online, it's only more predominantly it's Facebook, right? So they used to like, you know, have a concert and for a set of musicians, okay? When they invite, they just say that, oh, we like to have your concert, fine, okay? Someone called me from Delhi, okay? So they would like to have your concert, it's fine. So we just need a half an hour of your video and we like to stream it, fine, thank you. That's it, end of the conversation. They assume that it's understood that, okay, we are doing it for a free, you know? Of course, we do a lot of charity activities, charity concert, everything, right? But it's people think that, you know, that, okay, everything is kind of, you know, it's okay, online streaming, okay, online concert, it's kind of free. So I decided after 3-4 months, I think I did one or two online thing for our close circle. After that, I decided not to do it because going forward, if you keep, if same thing happens, you know, people know, nobody will come to the concert hall. And I mean, when I say in general, you know, maybe even 100 out of 100, even in 15, 20, if they say, okay, we are in a happy sitting at home and watching on a big screen, you know, then it's not a good situation, right? So then I decided, okay, we need to stop this. First, let's if anybody invites us, then we'll ask them to, you know, pay, of course, not the regular fee, some kind of fee for any musician. Then I decided, okay, since why don't we start like from the foundation, let's start online concert. We'll pay them the musician, whatever they're like get in a regular concert, if they're doing in a live concert. So that's why we started this online concerts. And I can say that many, almost 80 to 90% of the musicians in the South Indian, whomever I like, you know, came across, they are kind of hit badly, you know, very much. Somehow, by God's grace, I'm able to tally the balance sheet every month. So, but others, it's kind of very, very tough. From our foundation, we try to raise about some amount, like about 8 lakhs, and we give to 70, 75 needy musicians. We try to support it using the online platform, using our festival videos, and you know, streaming it for a nominal kind of thing. But one good thing at this point is every musician supported each other. That's what is, you know, when I talk, this is, I get goosebumps because every corner, I spoke to every musician because the musicians who involved for my festival, everyone said, please go ahead and use the video and you can just, you know, raise the fund for anything. So that's one of the things. I think now at this point, I can say that online streaming is just 5 to 10%, you know, that's it. Slowly, thankfully, in India, the live concerts are kind of back on stage.
Sure, that's good to hear. And thank you for sharing that. You're absolutely right that there was a lot of support that we saw from within the community. And I think that's one thing that's come out of—
That's the best part of the—
Positive, yeah. So it's interesting that I see that three of you, Tejasvi, Rebecca, and Giri, you all talked about, you know, turning to education, turning to upskilling. And you all have some amount of a structure behind you, whether it's a foundation, whether it's a creative entrepreneurship business, whether it's a theater space. I'm going to come to you now, Vishal, because, you know, I recently saw a post that you put on Instagram, which really struck me. And you were talking about applying to grants, applying to different funding opportunities, and how much an independent artist has to really work at to get that kind of support. So can you tell us what looking for revenue streams has been like for you and for other independent artists that you know?
So I work a lot in the media art space, but I also freelance making travel films, corporate films, which used to be my day job before COVID. I mean, the situation for artists in general was bleak anyway, especially in the visual arts. Also, if you're not doing any traditional form, funding bodies, grant making organizations don't understand what it is that you're doing. So in some ways, the kind of pains that people, other organizations, other, like just now what Kirada said, those things have existed for us for years before, right? We always had issues about trying to reach audiences because we're working remotely, we're working collaboratively. A lot of our practice is anyway mediated through technology. So for me personally, I was very lucky for 2020 because all the things that was working against me before that happened to be the thing that was working for me. I was already working remotely. I was already collaborating with people across the globe, really. And funding bodies outside of the country and institutions outside of the country are far more, sort of they have a more dynamic approach. They're more responsive about adapting very quickly to what the sector really needs. So I've been fortunate. It's a very, very unusual year, but I've been fortunate that most of the things that I was trying to do came through, which is not to say that I didn't, which is not to say that I could do everything that I wanted to, but it was marginally a better year than most. Before that, I would mostly use my freelance income to supplement artistic practice. Now it's kind of turned the other way around. Just this one year has kind of turned the other way around because I can't travel anyway. But also a lot of us working in the media art or tech art space, we don't really sell products, right? We don't make art objects. We're not selling photographs on the wall. We're mostly reliant on funding to sustain because a lot of it is experimental. A lot of it is exploratory conversations about the kind of research that we're doing. But I have been doing, I was anyway doing multiple things before, aside from making films. I was kind of building websites sometimes, helping out other artists, some smaller organizations with doing stuff on digital platforms. These are things that a lot of media artists, we were using way before, right? Like Zoom is a conversation thing now, but we were using conferencing tools much before to conduct performances, to do screenings, to do a lot of things that have now become the norm. So in some ways, I guess we're ahead of the curve, but it's kind of, it depends on how many people actually recognize that. The first couple of waves of things moving online was just recreating physical spaces, or like a lot of what Kirada said just resonated with me because a musician can't really perform the same way on Zoom as they would on stage. Zoom also cannot support that kind of bandwidth to do that. So a lot of it is also thinking critically about technology with other artists, which has been helpful because that means that some of us can actually lead and facilitate those conversations because we've been doing that anyway. Some of those projects are paid, and then look, going into 2021, that will continue from what I understand, because this is like it's multiple waves around the world. But also, yeah, I'm working on developing workshops, kind of, I curate some projects sometimes. So it's always a hustle though. It's as if you don't have, especially like I haven't been able to get any funding in the country in the last how many ever years I've been applying to funding here. And a lot of times the process of educating the funding bodies about, hey, what is the stuff that you're looking at in media arts becomes difficult, and it's labor that a lot of us don't really want to perform after some time. So I don't really even apply to a lot of things in the country. It's just I'm reliant on stuff outside. They seem to understand what I'm doing. The conversations are easier, pay is a lot fairer. Terms are pretty clear and transparent, which is a big issue also in visual arts, and they pay you up front. So that's kind of where I'm at.
Okay, thanks for that. I'm gonna ask you another question, and then I'll invite Tejasvi, Rebecca, Giri to pitch in as you see fit. But Vishal, you mentioned, you know, you're doing many different things. Can you tell us how you work towards developing those different skills? Because it can't be out of the blue, right? They're probably all connected. So what I'm trying to get at is, when we're looking at different revenue streams, you're obviously building on some core competencies, and then you're looking at opportunities. So if you can walk us through that process of how you approach that, that would be, I think, very interesting.
Cool. So for me, primarily the way I work is I think of it as two separate businesses. The freelance stuff is pretty much straight up commercial. It is not where I'm trying to go and flex any creative muscle. A lot of it is, of course, there's some creativity, but a lot of it is really what the client needs. And I'd like to keep it that way, because it just helps me do more experimental things in my own practice. Before I used to do all of this, I was a music photographer for many years. And before that, I was a banker. So I have a fairly decent grasp of understanding things like admin, things like maintaining books, accounting, taxation, investment, finances, things like this. So I'm not like a wizard or anything, but if I get 50 grand, I know how to make that 50 grand last for 2 years if I need to. So I have emergency funds in that case. But most of it is just identifying or understanding what people are really looking for. Like, I'll give an example within the freelance stuff. I work with travel companies, and a lot of times they're looking to minimize how many people they can take on their tours. So the more skills I pick up, it just means that I have a better shot of pitching for that project. The way I pitch is also mostly through networking. A lot of it is through networking. Because of working many years as in the music scene, just knowing how brands solicit stuff from freelancers, they kind of have a way of working. Those things are also, it comes from just also asking people who've been doing that for a while, which is a sense of saying, oh, maybe I shouldn't ask them. Maybe it'll seem like I don't know my stuff, but actually, like, the reality is a lot bleaker. So people are really helpful. They will tell you what it is that you need to do. With the other stuff that I'm doing is mostly coming from saying, what is it that I know that I can teach somebody else? And that manifests itself within artistic practice, within curation, sometimes as workshops. But it's also understanding how people learn. Like, I learn better with audio and visual aids. It works better for me. So if that seems to be something that I know how to do, I'm just going to continue doing that. And then it's just a matter of, like, looking at who it might be helpful for. So if it's a small theater organization, let's say in Bombay, like a conversation I was having last year, who wanted to, was a small collective, they want to go online, they want to do something. So there's only a few things that I can help. I can't really help them with the theater part of it. But what I can help them is just saying that these are some of the platforms that you could use, websites wise. And also through many years of, like, picking up skills. Okay, so the main part is, like, just concentrating on developing skills pretty much every month. It's a hectic process. I would not suggest anybody else do it, but it just, for me, I have uses for it. So if I understand how to work with audio, then I know I can consult and tell somebody how to implement audio for a theater performance that they need to host online and how they need to work through that. And a lot of it is just constantly asking friends and other collaborators to teach me stuff I don't know, which all eventually, like, it's the same thing. I exchange skills with them and they teach me stuff and I teach them things. That is pretty much how I approach stuff. But there's sometimes I cold call, I send emails to clients if I really want to work with them. If there's somebody really interesting doing something cool marketing wise, I tend to do that. But more often than not, I can just find somebody. At least if it's in Bangalore, I tend to, like, find somebody who knows somebody who can put me in touch.
Sure. Thanks for that. I think definitely networking is key, but not to do it as networking. I think just reaching out and connecting to people makes sense. So anyone else, Tejasvi, Giri, Rebecca, would you like to talk about how your communities have been looking at, you know, these different revenue streams, but also looking at developing new skills, maybe going in different directions, different but related directions. Any thoughts? Sure, go ahead.
Okay, yeah. No, I just wanted to add something which I was thinking about saying earlier and I didn't, which is that I think one of the things that was a big deal for us to figure on the pandemic was to sort of, I think all of us who structure financial planning think of it always as a larger picture, right? Like even what Vishal was just saying in terms of like you have, say, $50,000 and then you think about how you can make that stretch across multiple projects. I think what we've really been working on is now looking at smaller projects and sort of thinking of the theater as being a collection of smaller economies. So there's education that can, you know, sort of finance certain things in and of itself, but it can also feed and support XYZ other sort of expenditures, rather than sort of think about larger incomes which come from ticket sales and that come from grants and funding and donors. So we were thinking about this when we decided that we wanted to open up for small donations, and we kept thinking, I mean, if we were to open up to really small donations, then how far can that go? But in sort of looking at this large picture as being a larger unit of small, little expenses, but also in its own way, spaces to create income for its own little department is difficult, but it's a way forward, because then you're thinking about every space in the theater, and you're thinking, how can I use this space to create some income or to support itself? Because I think the other thing that we realized during the pandemic is that if we're not self-sustainable, then our, you know, our time is limited, because everyone's been hit by the pandemic. So the amount of funding that's available to us, the amounts that companies are willing to support us by giving, has all taken a hit. So now we really have to start looking at simple things. Like if I was someone, because I'm an actor and director, I'm not somebody who looks at the budget when I'm producing a show. I want to just do it. And sometimes you do things because you love to, but like we're really right now just saying if the show can't generate a particular sort of audience, and is not going to work to generate and support itself, then we're not going to do that show right now. So I think the hit is then to independent artists, because festivals is something that you always lose money, you know, at. You never stand to make a profit at a festival. So things like taking festivals out for this year, and replacing it with little projects that can, you know, cater to different audiences is just one of the other things that we've started doing.
Thanks for that. And I'm seeing, I don't know if anyone else sees this, but I see a parallel between even just project management, right? When you look at a large project, the best way to approach it, if it's overwhelming, is to try and break it down into smaller bits. And that's something like what you've done, to chunk it, to see how each small unit can work for itself. Thanks for that. Tejasvi, I noticed that you had unmuted yourself.
Yeah. So there were two things I wanted to kind of highlight. One is in terms of the capacity building initiatives, which Ririti started for the sector, for the museum professionals, and what we have observed within the sector post, you know, these conversations which we've had with them. So there were three main things which we did during the last year for museum professionals. One was something called the Talking Museum Series, where we kind of invite 4 to 6 museum professionals It's a curated closed group discussion. They come, it's an informal chai pe charcha kind of a conversations. And the main topic for the first season was how did all of them, kind of responded to COVID and what are the initiatives and measures they are taking to kind of just sustain themselves and pivot themselves. And what is the strategy once things open up? So those were the three main focus areas which we were discussing. And these Talking Museum series, the groups are very carefully curated. So we kind of have a good mix of, say, big museums with small museums, rural with urban museums. Their collections also vary. So there's a lot of, knowledge exchange happening at a very informal level. Usually what we've noticed is museum professionals all work in silos. And when they're meeting in a conference, it's also, hello, which museum, what do you do? And that's it. And then there are no further conversations or those don't turn into friendships. And what we realized is during the pandemic, the social element of meeting people was something which people really missed out on. You had your online knowledge, you were working, but the interaction, the human interaction was something which everybody, all of us were missing. And that's how we kind of addressed that gap through these Talking Museum series. And it went beyond the group discussion, because then our aim was they eventually would kind of contact each other and take it forward, which did happen. So now we are doing our second series. The second one from this also was something called the Insta Swap series, which some museums had it, but the others who didn't have like a following or didn't know how to go about it also kind of got onto it. And that was something which we saw, it was fresh content for the museum audiences of, the respective museums. So that also opened different kinds of engagement and different kinds of collaborations between the museum sector. And the third one was the capacity building workshops, which we started. This was something which we wanted to start in our first year, but for a physical workshop, it takes much more resources. So we had always like, we'll do it next year. And that eventually didn't happen. But because of everything going virtual, people had accepted, okay, workshop virtual. Yes, definitely. That was the norm last year, right? So we were able to kind of do that. I think the key to kind of moving ahead and the key to us being successful last year was collaborations. We extensively collaborated and museums were open to collaborate with each other versus compete with each other. So earlier, we would see a lot of competition between, organizations, whether not just in the museum sector, but we saw it in the education space as well. But COVID kind of brought people, opened new doors, and they were open to kind of experimenting and collaborating without being insecure. So I think that was a major difference which we saw within the museum sector.
Okay, thank you for sharing that. And thanks for also talking about those initiatives, which I think are critical, right? Because I think it was Vikram Iyengar who, during the Contagion series, one of the things he said when he was talking to us about it was the community has to help themselves. We have to help ourselves. We can't really expect external help. And as many of you have mentioned, all of you have mentioned in some way, form or shape, funding from external sources within India is going to be tough. It's always going to be a challenge. It has been. We don't really see anything changing in the near future. But it's absolutely right. And thank you for helping bring the museum community together.
Absolutely, because that was also one of the things which we had in mind, that we cannot wait for corporates and government to help us. We need to help each other. And that's how this entire way forward happened.
Yeah. Before I come to Giri, Tejasi, there's a question from Vivek in the chat and I'll read it out. Can you elaborate with some examples of collaborations, and do you think this spirit of togetherness will continue? I assume once everything is back to normal.
I think trust is a major important factor in collaborations. And if you're able to establish that trust and have transparent processes and clear expectations, it can go forward. between the institutions. And I think the first thing is clearing expectations and your, you know, roles between each other. Some of the examples which we did for collaboration is for our capacity building workshops. We could have done it by ourselves, but we chose to collaborate. Each time we did a workshop, we would collaborate with a museum. So that way the museum also got visibility and they had an opportunity to share with the other museum professionals. So they kind of opened up their resources. And it also worked for us that our agenda was to kind of bring the community closer, because there is no association, museums association of sorts in India. You know, there is no place like how ACRI or ArtX is bringing the cultural field, cultural music professionals together. It's something similar which we are doing in the museum sector. So that kind of helped. Some of the collaborations which came out of the Talking Museum series is where they independently kind of contacted each other. It could be simple things like, okay, I have a coin collection which is lying. I don't know how to go about the restoration of it. And there was on that panel, on that discussion, there was a museum which had extensively done their documentation and preservation of, you know, the coin collection which they had. So then they took it to the next level, and both of them are now kind of collaborating on not physical exchange, but, you know, over online stuff, they're doing a lot of things. And then the other museums kind of collaborated. They had off programs to offer, so they swapped it for their school kids, you know, that we would offer this. We have like 4 offerings from our museum. We will add yours also, and you do the same for us. If you have, if you don't have, that's also fine. It was not like we had to do something. You have to give us something in exchange. So that entire space opened up. I feel that if they see a positive impact created by these collaborations, people will continue to collaborate. I'm positive about that.
Okay, that's awesome. I'm going to come to Giri just for a quick question before we come to the next question, which is for Vishal, if you want to look in the chat as well. Giri, you know, you talked about, and we've talked about this spirit of togetherness, and you mentioned that you were able to raise emergency funding for the classical, I assume it's the classical musician community and musicians who have been affected within that space. Have you noticed any sort of change? Because I this is personal experience, and do correct me if I'm wrong, but often with classical musicians, there are music, there are bastions, there are these, you know, camps. Have you noticed any sort of change that's occurred over the last year? And this is, of course, veering slightly away from the issue of finances, but we'll come back to that. But I'd be keen to hear about that from you, Giri.
Groups as in what kind of groups, like?
So at least with Hindustani classical, there are gharanas, and those are, you know, those are sort of groups.
Okay, in music, in Carnatic music, of course, there's nothing, no gharanas or anything. It's just the guru and the students. I can say that I just recently in one of the interviews, I said, in Ghatam, there is no gharana. If at all, if there is any gharana, it has to be only Bhikkhu gharana. So probably that's the first gharana exists in Carnatic music. Bhikkhu Vinayakaram, our great guru. So he's the only, the pioneer in the Ghatam. So that's a gharana system. Just to add to a couple of things to whatever Tejasvi said, one of the positive things happened in the last few months is that online teaching, which was I used to teach maybe like a couple of students or 3 students maximum, you know. I always say, I hesitate, like, you know, I don't want to teach online, because music is always good when we do it one-on-one directly, because it's easy to teach. Then there is a exchange of some good vibes. Everything is happening. But thanks to this COVID, everything has changed. I can tell you, every musician, not just in South, in North, they have used this online platform. You name any musician, I can openly say, I've seen every musician teaching online. See, it's very difficult, because teaching online is because of the latency, because we cannot sing or we cannot perform together at the same time, right? Because of the latency. So that's the biggest disadvantage. But still, we somehow tried to overcome that and somehow find a space, find a route to teach. Well, I'm teaching Ghatam, and I can say that probably in the last 7 months, a bunch of students across the globe started learning Ghatam, you know, because I just put a word somewhere in Instagram. Somebody asked me in one Q&A that whether I'm teaching or not. I just said, yes, I'm teaching. I'm using this space and time to teach. And suddenly people started to learn. So this is a big thing. And going forward, this is a, because I tried to figure out, and I'm same thing with, it could be a Veena player or a violin player. Everyone has tried to, you know, find some kind of, you know, situation that way they can teach online also. So this is a very positive thing. And other thing is, as I already told, people are supporting. It's not just between the musicians community, someone like concert halls, Chowdhury Hall, they trying to do, you know, cut down the 50% and they're ready to give for a 50% or even less than that. They can have a, we can have a concert there, organize a concert there. And kind of, you know, they're not bothered about their regular fees. Okay. Like, you know, what they generally take for them, for all of us, it's like, we want to play. The main thing, it's not just the money. Let me tell you, when I play, it's the main soul, the main energy coming for the soul is by playing, you know. So I used to get all the good energy, the positive energy when I play concert, and I could come back home and help my wife in cleaning or something, you know. That was the kind of motivation, okay. But now, because the concerts are not there, that's kind of, you know, kind of we are trying to kick ourselves and try to do something, push, you know. Whatever practice we do, you know, ultimately the playing for live concert, forget about playing in front of a camera or a thing. It's just maybe 5% we get the energy, but it's for the live audience is the best thing happened to any performing artist, I should say.
Absolutely. And I think for people like me who aren't on stage, I think that's even more brought into the foreground, that it's something that's just completely irreplaceable. I also want to mention, since you talked about latency being a real problem with artists, and Vishal, we'll come to the two questions that are for you in the chat next. But I wanted to mention, I recently spoke with another Carnatic classical musician, Vivek Rajgopalan, who in the pandemic with a partner has created something called Art Square Feet, which is a platform for musicians primarily, because that's his particular area of interest, which tries to address this latency issue.
Yeah. I mean, I did perform a concert with this, you know, one of the musicians in Chennai. He kind of, you know, figured out how to do this concert. So there was two violin duets, Ganesh Kumaresh, I'm sure most of you know. Ganesh and Murdangam player, they were playing in Chennai. Kumaresh and I was playing in Bangalore. We somehow achieved for about 1 hour. We could do this because of, you know, the technology to do this. You know. So, but it's again, as I told you, it's like, you know, we need to just, with the headphones, and we need to think, okay, he's been playing like this. You know, we need to assume something kind of thing. It's not the exact the live feeling, but something is better than nothing. So it's kind of, still it's fine once in a while.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thanks for sharing that. That was nice. So I'm also aware of the time digital fatigue, as I mentioned. So we try to keep our sessions to about an hour. We're at 7:28, so we'll go on for maybe another a maximum of 10 minutes more, because I do want to have us address these two questions. Vishal, both are for you. How do you suggest independent artists approach savings or investments as a way to deal with precarity? Very important. What sort of financial planning can take place to support the stretching out of funds during a lean time? Would you like to take that one first?
Yeah, I'll actually do it the other way. I'll take Anusha's question and then I'll go to Swani.
All right.
The cold calling part, this is a last resort scenario for me, particularly because I'm fairly, not to be arrogant, but I'm fairly confident that I can, like, if I'm patient, if it's not time sensitive, then I'm fairly sort of, I understand that I can find somebody who knows the person I'm trying to reach. Or in extreme scenarios, I kind of try and see who they've worked with and then towards them, because it's easier if a client's worked with another photographer or a filmmaker and have a conversation as a peer and then go to their client, as opposed to directly reaching out to the client. So that's one way that I negotiate that. But most of it is really also networking. Like I have regular conversations with people, not because I have a project in mind, but maybe in 6 months when they have something, they will think of me. That's primarily how I've built all of my clients. Also just kind of keeping people updated. Shame is a thing, but you can't really, it's not the luxury of artists to be that shameful. Like there's some things we have to promote ourselves. So just constantly dropping things here and there, saying, oh yeah, cool, I worked on this thing and I used this new piece of gear, a new piece of equipment, which kind of triggers people's thinking in a certain way. As for Swani's question, I do a few things. A running joke among some of my friends is that I have small funds for everything that I need, which is a phone, a pair of shoes, and some stationery. That's pretty much like the fund that I have. The whole, like, if I buy a phone now, like for the next 5 years, I'm gonna have like put small amounts of money towards buying the next one in 5 years. Primarily because it's the main tool that I use on an everyday basis, and so are shoes. But it's the same principle for managing money that I do. I just put smaller amounts of money. Personally, I can tell you I have a systematic investment plan, which is basically just put $1,000 or $2,000 every month into something. We can talk more about this, Swani. We can discuss this, but and then also understanding what are the ways in which just understanding things like unit economics, how much does it actually cost for a time of your, for an hour of your time, and how much labor is you can afford to give in that 1 hour, because artists have a tendency to take on a lot more than we can afford to give. So if a project's going to take me 10 hours, then I'm definitely trying to budget 20 hours because I know dealing and speaking to clients is going to take that much amount of time. So the way I look at like putting money aside is also quite similar. So I take smaller chunks of money, put it in different places. But if I do happen to come into a larger chunk of money, then I save 50% of it. I can afford to at the moment because I'm staying with my folks. But and all of that goes into the best way that I found right now in India is into a post office savings account. It's still, we can talk further about this. But the other is also to, if you put into something that will give you money every month or so, even though it might not be a lot, even if it's just $5,000, it's still it saves you from going like getting stuck in the loop of I don't have any work and I'm not able to make work, and you're just constantly, you know, oscillating between those. So that's pretty much all I do, and then maybe if there's any questions we can talk about it afterwards, but also I have to run. So sorry about that. Thank you for having me.
Yes, thank you. I think that's a good note to end on. Perhaps that's something that we can talk about in another ACRI session. But just a reminder, or before I go to that, Tejasvi, Giri, Vishal, Rebecca, thank you so much. I appreciate you joining this conversation, admittedly at short notice, but I really appreciate your insights. You've spoken all very honestly, and I do appreciate that. Thank you for sharing so generously in this session.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you. So Vishal, if you need to, you can jump off, but I just want to leave with these final thoughts that ACRI sessions do happen twice a month at the least on the first and third Wednesdays of each month. So we will be having similar conversations. And a reminder that CultureCon, ACRI's Arts Management Conference, is coming up on the 19th and 20th of March, which is open to ACRI members. So do look for more information on the ACRI Culture India Instagram page, and of course the ACRI Facebook group as well. So I will end this session now, but feel free to get in touch with us if you'd like to see more sessions like this, if you'd like to perhaps do a session on taxation and investment planning, we'd be happy to put that together for you. But for now, I will bid you all a good evening. Thanks again to all our speakers, and thank you all for joining us.
Thank you. Bye.
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 Ciao.